I'm reminded of a situation that happened in a Sunday school class. They're in church, and the Sunday school teacher asked a question of the six-year-olds. She asked him, she says, "What is gray, has a bushy tail, climbs in trees, and eats nuts?" Dead silence. And one of the little boys said this. He says, "The answer's got to be Jesus, but it sure sounds like a squirrel." Now, any other place, you'd know that the answer was Jesus. But given that context, asking that question, you say, okay, Jesus has got to fit in here some kind of way. If you get that, if you get how the environment can influence something that should be fairly straightforward, then you'll get what I'm trying to communicate today. We've been talking about a theology called replacement theology. And I felt like I needed to kind of hit a pause because there are related subjects here. Subjects about the church and subjects about what the end times are. Those kind of conflate in our lesson this morning. What I thought I would do, we've been talking about replacement theology, and I felt like you needed to be prepared, because I don't want to preach to a group of learners. I want you to learn, but I want you to think. I want you to be thinkers as well. So that's what we're going to do this morning. So the first question, or the first part of this that I want to get into, is replacement theology. Rod, you make it sound like you've got to be a joker to buy into replacement theology. You make it seem like it's so clear-cut, but it really isn't, is it? And what I would like to do for the first few moments this morning is help you see things from their perspective and let you know why they believe what they believe. So we're going to get started right where Raquel read the scripture. And we're going to ask this question, what is the church? What entity is the church? What does the church look like? What are we supposed to make of the church? Is the church Gentile? Is the church Jewish? Is the church a mixture of both? Well, that was kind of the question that the disciples had, the apostles had, after the resurrection of Christ. We know the church wasn't in the Old Testament. Let's just be clear about that. Because when Peter says what he says about you're the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus says, you've answered right, and I'm going to build my church. I will do something in the future, and it's going to be called church. So he rises from the dead, and you've got these 12 Jewish boys, 11 at least, good Jewish boys, that are sitting around, and they're wondering, okay, what's next? And the most logical next is the kingdom. Because in the Old Testament, all of these promises have been made. Jacob, who we've been studying about, Jacob has been given promises. His father Isaac had been given promises. His father Abraham has been given promises. And all of these promises have been made. And so now we say, okay, is the kingdom going to come? And Jesus doesn't answer that question. Instead, he says this. He says what Raquel read. Because they said, are you going to restore the kingdom of Israel at this time? He says, not for you to know. He says, but you do what you're supposed to do. So 32 AD, 33 AD, we're wondering, what are we? The church is wondering. It's Jewish. It's very Jewish. The people who heard that first message in Acts chapter 2 were Jews that had come from all over to hear that message. That Jesus, that the Messiah, had not only come, but he had died on a cross for their sins and he had risen again. And so they are kind of going through, kind of wondering about their identity. In fact, in the early church, they went to church twice. They went to Jewish synagogue and they went to church. Because they're trying to figure out who they are. Are they, you know, does the Old Testament even matter anymore? Because Jesus is doing something, and yeah, he had said everything he did, everything that was written in the Old Testament was about him. And so we have, for the next 38 years, the church is trying to find its identity. And the message is about, hey, what are you going to do with the empty tomb? The empty tomb is verifiable. It's right there. It's empty. The disciples didn't steal it. There's no way they could have done it from the most powerful army on earth. So what are you going to do about that? And that was the message over and over again. It's, well, you've got to deal with this. You've got to deal with this evidence, these facts. And then something happens, and we actually have a picture of what that. Someone took a picture back then that changed everything. It brought to conclusion. It brought to a point to where, okay, that settles it. And I want to show you the picture. It's the same picture, but it's done two different ones. Here's the picture. Oh, yeah. I am so used to going this way. Here's the picture. This picture is in Rome. It's the Titus, the Arch of Titus. And what it is a picture, a carving of what happened in 70 AD when Titus conquers Jerusalem. Now, he doesn't only just conquer the city. He does something more than that. He tears down the temple. There's not a stone upon stone. I've been to Israel 3 times, and you can go there today, and you can still see the stones that he overturned that are right there. He overturned everything. So now if you're sitting there and you're wondering, you're going, okay, what are we? There's no more temple. The Jews have been scattered. They're looking for a place to land. There's no more. But what about the promises from the Old Testament? And theologians thought about this from 70 AD on. And here was their solution. Oh, we must be Israel. The church must be Israel. And they start reading the Old Testament. They start reading all of those promises. That must have been for us. We must be the Old Testament. And every single great theologian believed that now the church was Israel, or that Israel was the church. And they started talking about things in such a way that, like, Israel was grafted into the church. And they didn't use that language, but that's essentially where their theology led them. And every great theologian, be it Augustine, be it Anselm, Aquinas, Martin Luther, all of them believe that. And for church history, all of them believe that. Now, I got to tell you, there is one that didn't believe that. And I would argue it's the Apostle Paul. But here's what you got to think about. When Paul was writing, guess what was standing? The temple. Paul dies before the temple is torn down. So Paul sees this distinction. We'll look at it here in just a second. He sees this distinction. That's another picture of this event that happens that changes everything. So for the next 2,000 years, people will just assume that Israel, the identity of Israel, the promises of Israel are consummated in the church. And the church holds that. Now, Scripture doesn't tell us that. It doesn't tell us if there's no more temple, then we're going to switch to this plan. Because the temple is talked about in the Old Testament, that there's going to be a temple, there's going to be a kingdom, there's going to be all of these promises. But we end up thinking, okay, wait, how are we to put this together? And it becomes very confusing. And so every writer, and this is why in the scholarly community, they refer to the great theologians of the past. But when you do that, what are you doing? You're referring to great theologians who had to come up with the answer because of the event of Titus tearing down not only Jerusalem, but the temple. Along comes different ideas and people. There were people that just, they didn't worry about theology. They just said, what does the Bible say? To me, it is amazing that the apostles kept the Old Testament. For whatever reason, the apostles kept the Old Testament. They said, whatever God is doing, he's not abandoning what he said back then. And so they wrestled with this. So for the Christian, both of these books, the left side of the book, when you open your Bible, the left side, the Old Testament, and the right side, both of these books are sought and thought of to be the Word of God. That God wants Christian believers to know both sides of this book. So people are reading and reading, and around 1800, there's a man born whose last name is Darby. And he wasn't the first to come up with this, but they're reading, and they said, you know, there's got to be an Israel. There's got to be an Israel. And he is credited with being the father of dispensationalism. Now, I went to a dispensational school, and here's really all that means. I'm going to break that down to the barest bone of this. If you believe that Israel and the church are one entity, then you are replacement theology. You are what's called Reformed theology after Martin Luther and the Reform. If you believe that Israel and the church are two distinct entities, then you're what's called a dispensational. Now, they talk about different things, but that's essentially where we land. Now, let me go back just for a second. When the temple was destroyed, and the church is setting up its offices, and it's saying, how do we run this show? What do we do? They look back in the Old Testament. And so many of you are come from the Catholic background, Catholic church. What do you call your pastor? You call him a priest. Where do they get that idea of priest? From the Old Testament, priest. Many of you were baptized as an infant. Where do they get that idea? From the Old Testament, because circumcision happened in the Old Testament. And so the thought is, okay, if we're supposed to implement some of these things, let's do baptism of infants to show that they're part of God's family, part of the covenant. In fact, it would end up being like this. What we've talked about in Genesis, remember, the older son is supplanted by the younger son. The younger son rises. Well, you could say, well, Israel was the older son, and now the church is the younger son. And the younger son's going to rise. She had all of this whole wave of thinking and writing says the church and Israel must be one. But in the mid-1800s, for a group of people to start talking about Israel and the church was laughable. Why? There's still no temple. There's still a destroyed Jerusalem. But more than that, there ain't no Israel. It's not there. And so if you're going into the pulpit and you're preaching and you're saying God's got a plan to Israel, you're kind of looking and you're lifting up the covers and you're looking under the sofa and it, like looking for your keys. There's no Israel. And that movement, the fundamentalist movement that came in into the community, into the university setting, and in the early 20s, there were battles, in the early 1900s, there were battles over the nature of God's word and God's promises. Because there wasn't any Israel. And God had given his promises. So God's promises must not be in effect, or close might be close enough. The church, yeah, let's just slide that in there. Well, now, 1948, everything changed. And now there is an Israel. And you know what my covenant friends will tell me? You're just making that decision because of the times, because there is an Israel. Now, wait a minute. You're telling me that I am looking and seeing what's out there, and I'm allowing that to shape my theology. Yeah, but didn't you do the same thing in 70 AD? Didn't you look and see no temple, no Jerusalem, and then you decide that, hey, these promises must not be in effect? Aren't you guilty? Aren't you guilty of the same thing that you accuse me of being? Now, what I like to do is I like to go through some of these passages. And let me tell you, you're only getting half the passages that I should be going through. Okay, Olivia, I've got my whole passages up here, so I'm going to have you lead me through this. So, in the order I gave them to you in. Oh, gosh. Olivia, get that screen on. So, Genesis 15, and we talk about Genesis 15 at least once a year. You know what happened later in this passage, where God promises Abraham all of these promises, and then he goes through and he gathers these animals and he cuts these animals. He cuts the covenant, and Abraham is sleeping, and God himself goes through the animals. And he's saying this, that the responsibility for the promises being fulfilled rests totally on God. But we don't too much focus on the early part of the chapter, and that's what I want to talk about here. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Fear not, Abram, I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. Abraham, your reward's going to be great. But Abram said, oh, Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless, and the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus. And Abram said, behold, you have given me no offspring, and a member of my household will be married. Abraham says, okay, God, you're a good and gracious God. I have no child. Look, Eleazar, he's a member of my household. The promises will go through him. What Abram is saying right now is like in horseshoes. Close gets you a point. He's close enough. That'll be good. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. Your very own son shall be your heir. For God, close isn't close enough. Close doesn't fulfill the promise. And he brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and number the stars if you're able to number them. Then he said to them, so shall your offspring be. And he believed the Lord. Abram believed God. Didn't have any reason to believe him, because he's old and he doesn't have any kids. His wife's old, no kids. But he believed the Lord, and that was counted to him as righteousness. Here's the point. Eleazar could not step in and take over by Abram's own blood. There is something that Abram had to have, that his own child, his own bloodline, his own ethnicity needed to fulfill God's promise to him. Okay? Now, let's go to our next slide. I'm excited to see this, what he's going to put up here. Jesus is talking about, this is the end times. He's preparing his disciples. This is what's going to come. And he says this phrase in here. They will fall by the edge of the sword and be led captive among all nations, talking about the Jews, talking about God's people. And Jerusalem will be trampled underfoot by the Gentiles, 70 AD. Until, circle that word until in your Bible, until, as far as, until, the times of the Gentile are fulfilled. So this is going to be their state up until the times of the Gentiles are fulfilled. Look at what the Apostle Paul will say. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery. There's a mystery, and I want you to know what's coming. He says, brothers, a partial hardening has come upon Israel, ethnic Israel. Ethnic Israel, people that are of the bloodline of Israel. Because Genesis 15, bloodline's important. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, important. The 12 sons, the 12 tribes, important. A partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come. So whatever happens, the Gentiles are in control for a time. There's going to come a time where they're not going to be running the show. Okay? Now, what's my next one? And in this way, all Israel will be saved. It is written, the deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob, from ethnic Israel. And this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins. As regards the gospel, they are enemies for your sake. In other words, they have rejected the gospel. Ethnic Israel has rejected the gospel, but he's saying that's good for you. It's good for you because their rejection means the gospel goes out to the Gentiles, to the whole world. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. God still has something for them. God still has something for them. Remember, this is written before, in the late 50s AD. The temple hadn't been destroyed. Jerusalem hadn't been destroyed by Titus. Now, what is for them? And here comes, going to take that down for a second. Here comes a problem. If the church is the recipient of all of the promises meant to Israel, if the church says, okay, we fulfill this, there is one huge, glaring promise that the church never talks about. We don't think it's important. But just by reading Jacob and by talking about Jacob, you know it's important. Four-letter word. Starts with an L, ends with a D. Has an A and an N in the middle. The land. The land. The land. What do we do? God kept bringing up the land, the land, the land. As the church, do we say, yeah, he didn't mean that. Yeah, it wasn't important to him. Are we able to just overlook that and say, no, we're the new Israel. And as the new Israel, and now we are taking everything on and we're dealing with everything. The land. The land, over and over and over again, the land. The land is going to be kind of put aside, as it were, because the time of the Gentiles. Land doesn't mean anything to Gentiles. They inherited a land, we inherit a life. But then they are banished from the land for a while. They're taken into captivity. The nation splits, northern kingdom, southern kingdom. Northern kingdom is known as Israel or Ephraim. And southern is known as Judah. The two tribes of the southern kingdom is split. They're taken off later into the Babylonian captivity. And one of their princesses, one of their princes, I should say, and one of their scholars is taken off at a young age, and he becomes a leader in Babylon because he becomes an advisor. His name's Daniel. And here's what he writes, because he's reading Jeremiah, and he says, ooh, this is coming to an end. And he starts realizing that they're going to go back into the land. And so he says, 70 weeks are decreed about your people and your holy city. The focus on Daniel is your people. Who's Daniel's people? The Jew. What kind of Jew? Ethnic Jew. Close isn't close enough. It's not about the church. It's about Jews and your holy city. What's the holy city? Jerusalem, Jerusalem, Jerusalem. To finish the transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for iniquity, to bring in everlasting righteousness, to seal both vision and prophet, and to anoint a most holy place. And he, talking about the Antichrist, or the other part, again, I left out a lot of scripture here, shall make a strong covenant with many for 1 week, and for a half of the week he shall put an end to sacrifice and offering. And on the wing of abomination shall come one who makes desolate, until the decree end is poured out on the desolator. He says there's 69 weeks. There's 62 weeks and then 7 weeks and then a last week. The thought is that all 69 of those weeks have been taken care of up to Messiah. And we've hit the pause button and the church is doing her thing. And the church is trying to figure out what she is. The church knows her marching orders. Her marching orders are to go into all the world and preach the gospel. And tell people about what Messiah has done, what Christ has done, how Christ has paid for their sins. And so that's going on and on. And all of a sudden, we got Israel pops up. 1948, boom, Israel's here. And so we start looking. 1948, they don't have control of the city, though. The city's still under Jordanian control, Jordan control. Oh, 1968, they get control of Jerusalem. Oh, man. 2017, the United States recognizes that Jerusalem is Israel's. That Jerusalem is the capital. And people start putting their head on a swivel saying, what is going on here? What is going on here? Because there's another week coming. There's another week coming. It's coming. Go to my next verse. Jeremiah 30, verse 7 says this. This is the ESV, and when I quoted in the King James. Alas, that day is so great, there is none like it. It is a time of distress for Jacob, or it is a time for Jacob's trouble. There's coming a time for Jacob's trouble. It's known as Jacob's trouble. And you shall be saved out of it. There's going to be a time of Jacob's trouble. Now, the way that people deal with this whole thing about what's coming, the future, is they take Revelation and they put it back here. And I'm talking about some very good people. Because what they did in buying into 70 AD, changing the game, no temple, what they did is they said, okay, Revelation, the book of Revelation must be talking about 70 AD or 100 AD. Because it doesn't make sense any other way you do that. Now, I, for one, still believe that Revelation is talking about the future. The events that are given in Revelation are primarily from chapter 4 on talking about the future. Now, it's an interesting, odd thing that pops up. I think I know what my next verse is. Give me my next verse. Okay, Jeremiah 30:16. Therefore, all who devour you, talking about Israel, shall be devoured, and all your foes, every one of them, shall go into captivity. Those who plunder you shall be plundered, and all who prey on you, I will make a prey. There's a promise. God says, I haven't left Israel. I'm going to still be with you. No matter what you go through, I'm going to be there. And what's my next verse? Huh? Yeah. Oh. And I will restore health to you, and your wounds I will heal, declares the Lord, because they will call you an outcast. It is Zion for whom no one cares. Let me tell you, all you have to do is cut on the news today. And guess what? Everybody is singing off the same sheet music. It is Zion. No one cares about Zion. Zion doesn't matter. Unless maybe you're looking at different news than I am. That's the hymn that's being sung by the world. Zion is just a little bitty state that doesn't matter. It's just the land, it doesn't matter. From the river to the sea, it doesn't matter. Just. And the bullies of this world think they're in charge, think they can persuade people to come against Zion. And if you heard Benjamin Netanyahu's speech toward Congress this week, he says, never, never, never again, never again. Never again. Why would he say that? It's because he, for one, believes the promises of God in the Old Testament. He doesn't buy into the church is close enough. He believes God's got a future for Israel. Jews that came from all over the entire world to populate Israel. God was doing something. God was doing something. What's my next verse? Yes, Revelation chapter 7. Revelation. Because guess what shows up in Revelation chapter 7? And I heard the number of the sealed, 144,000 sealed from every tribe of the sons of Israel. And he goes on, did I give you more to do that? Yeah, 12,000 from the tribe of Judah were sealed. 12,000 from the tribe of Reuben. 12,000. The focus during the tribulation period is on the Jew. In fact, chapter 14 will tell you that these Jews are 144,000 virgin Jewish men. But when you read this, these people, you know, that's part of Jacob's family. That's the tribe. Why is Judah listed first? We know Reuben was born first. It's because of what Jacob promised Judah. Do I have any more scripture? Yeah, I'm not going to read all that. Do I have any more? Oh, that's it? That's it? Okay, so here's the deal. Our brothers and sisters, they have very good reason for believing in replacement theology. They're sitting in an environment, and everything in Scripture tells them it's a squirrel, but they figure it's got to be Jesus because of the environment. It's the church has got to be Israel because there is no temple. I was talking to a painter, the most famous painter in all of Israel. And we were in his shop and I was talking. And he took me back and he showed me a picture. He said, you see this picture right here? I said, ooh, I like it. He said, yeah, I painted it. It was hanging in Benjamin Netanyahu's office. And as soon as people realized the implication of that painting, they said, get that thing out of here. Because it showed a temple on the mount, on the Temple Mount. And the last thing they wanted to do is for a camera to pick up that he's got a Temple Mount, that he's got a temple on the Temple Mount. Friends, it's coming. It's coming. It can be built like that. There's a temple coming. Here's what I'm saying. God's promises in the Old Testament triumph anything your eyes will tell you. Great men and women that knew God and knew His Word, they said, with there being no temple, with there being no Jerusalem, how do we make all this stuff work? Oh, it must be the church. But there were people who said, no, God's true to His promises. God's going to do what He promised. He says, God's got to do something. And we couldn't figure it out, but God did it. God did it. And there's a nation of Israel today. There's not a temple, but it's coming. Rod, this sounds really good. And if I was in Bible college, I'd really enjoy this stuff. But why in the world would you take time to try to teach us this kind of thing? It's simply because of this. God's promises to you, no matter what your situation is, no matter if you say, how is God going to work this out? He can. Trust me, He can. He can bring the seen out of the unseen. He can bring that which is not known to be known. He can bring it out. And it's the triumph of a promise. Close isn't close enough. God is specific and particular in His promise. You know, here's what will happen with me. Y'all, if you've been around me, you know, if you see me doing some activity that's very unusual, we'll call it running. Very unusual for me to be doing that. But if you and I are running, I'll end up like, I'll say, hey, the finish line's right here, and then I won, you know. And then, if you know me, you'll probably say, no, the finish line's over there, and then you'll win, and we'll go back. We'll keep moving the finish line. That's what theologians were doing. They kept reading the Old Testament. Let's just move this thing. Let's move that. No. God knew exactly what He was promising. He knew what He was promising Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He knew what He was promising, and He knew that His promises would not put Him in a bind where God's over here saying, how are we going to get out of this? How are we going to do this? God knew, and you and I, living right now, we get to see this. Imagine if you were Luther, or Anselm, or Aquinas, or any of these great theologians, imagine if they could see what you see. Do you think they would be confused about Israel and the church? I don't think they would. I don't think they would. I think their circumstances lean them into that. And so what you have happening is, in the scholarly academic world, they very much rely on Luther and the other writers, be they Catholic, be they Protestant. They very much rely on that. But you know what has happened? In the church that teaches the Bible, the church, the pews have believed God for this for thousands of years. They believed. They were simple enough, and I use that word complimentary, to believe that God would do what God said He would do. And my wish and dream for all of us is that we would be simple enough to know that God's not in a bind. He has promised that He brings us into His family by simple faith. He brings us into that. And that He holds us. And He holds on to us. We don't have to worry about trying to get His attention. We don't have to worry about being good enough for it. He has provided in Christ for us as Gentiles to be grafted into Israel. We do receive some of the promises, but not all the promises. We do receive those. Again, not all the promises given to Israel. And because of their theology, see, they would say, hey, it's good enough for Jesus to reign in heaven. It's good enough for Jesus to reign over the hearts of men and women, boys and girls. That's good enough. That's His kingdom. No. No. He gave the promise. The book has the promise. And so you and I have to ask ourselves, Do we embrace the promise? Do we embrace the promise? Will there be a time where ethnic Israel will be turned to God? And I say, yes, full stop. Yes, exclamation point. Yes. And it is closer than you can imagine. In that time that Daniel talked about, that 7-year period of time, we're on the cusp of that. And God has something else for us. He promises. Now, eventually, we all are God's people, but I think we're still distinct now. What happens to Jews who end up trusting Christ as Messiah? They come into the church. They're part of the church. And let me tell you, it's happening like crazy. I heard this week of a testimony of a Muslim who came to Christ. How did he come to Christ? It was through reading the Quran that he came to Christ. It is amazing. What God is doing is absolutely amazing. Aren't you glad you worship a living God? A God who's not constrained by the events of history? His promises will always triumph. They will always triumph. And you can live each day banking on that promise. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would reveal to us how you have been meticulously involved in every aspect of our lives, the pain, the hurt, the battles that we have had to face. You have been there, and you've shaped us and transformed us to be more like Jesus through each and every battle. God, I thank you that we can live in a time where we can see right before our eyes unfolding your promises. May we always look to your word and your promises over the circumstances and over the majorities who might try to persuade us from them. May we trust you in the details of life and take that next step in an ever-growing relationship with Jesus. Because he changed everything. He changed the entire game. And he made it where all, Jew and Gentile, slave and free, men and women, can come to you and be part of your family. For it's in Christ's name I thank you. Amen.
Hi, friends. I'm Olivia.
I'm Rod.
And you're listening to Just One More Thing from Sunrise Church. Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of Just One More Thing from Sunrise Church. In today's episode, we are covering the July 28th sermon titled Triumph of a Promise Kept. The first thing I'm going to say about this is this was not the sermon that you 2 weeks ago said you were going to preach.
Correct.
You had to kind of hit the pause button on your original plan and you shifted gears to cover replacement theology and kind of the thought process behind that movement, which went back way farther than I thought in the history book. So can you explain why you wanted to switch to this?
Well, I don't know if I can tell you why I did that. Honestly, I told you that I was struggling. I had two messages that I was wrestling with. I ended up at the last minute jettisoning one, the one I was going to preach, to do this one. I just felt like a lot of times we critique an idea and we do it from a standpoint of a biasness towards our own idea, and we don't understand the other idea that we're critiquing. And so I took some time in my own study to say, okay, why replacement theology? If this is so absurd, why does it get a foothold? And when I start looking at it and reading and all, I said, okay, if I walked a mile in their shoes, then I can get there. I can understand it. because most of church history, 90 plus percent of church history, has had that view of replacement theology. And I argued that it's all centered around the absence of a temple in Jerusalem. No one argues over, I don't think anyone argues, over the fact that there was quite a few discussions on what the identity of the church was after the ascension. In fact, the scripture verse we read in Acts chapter 1, verse 6 and 7, you know, the disciples wanted to know, are you now going to bring the kingdom? You've done something we weren't expecting. We were expecting you to overthrow Rome for the kingdom to come in then, but you died on the cross. We understand that you paid a sin debt. But are you going to overthrow, are you going to bring in the kingdom now? And Jesus, he didn't say, no, the kingdom plan has been scratched. You know, we're not doing that. Mark that off your cards. He just said, that's not for you to know. He said, but here's what you're going to do. And he gave the church their marching orders. But there was still some confusion. Are we Jewish? Are we Gentiles? Are we, you know, what culture does the church take on? The Apostle Paul will argue this at the Jerusalem Council. And those arguments kept going on. That confusion kept going on. Paul writes, you know, you're trying to become Jewish and you don't need to do any more. You don't need to be circumcised because you're taking the cross of Christ and you're making it of no effect because you're going to end up buying into the rules, into the law. You're going to try to do the Jewish thing, and that's not what Christ has done. Christ has come to fulfill the law. So after the fall of the temple, those discussions became a lot more clear. There's not a choice. And so once you understand that, and once you understand that every theologian is really writing from that perspective, assuming, and people would argue with me on this, but assuming that now Israel has been grafted into the church. And I mean that like I said it. That's the mindset, thinking that now Israel has come into the church. When Paul makes that very clear, nothing could be further from the truth. The church has been grafted into Israel. So I believe that distinction remained, the distinction between ethnic Israel, ethnic Jews, and the church. And so once every theologian buys into the confusion that Israel has been grafted into the church, then we have almost 2,000 years of church history where people are writing from that perspective. And so it's a big deal to go against that. And all along the way, people, individuals maybe did read scripture from a literal point of view. The land mattered. The promises God made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob mattered. And the question was, okay, does God fulfill his promise? Because it sure doesn't look like it. There's no Israel. They've been scattered. There's no temple. That's been torn down. It doesn't look like God can come through on his promises. Or God has shifted to plan B. I would argue that the church is not plan B. It was in the providence of God all along. But God hasn't abandoned plan A. And I think that's what Romans chapter 11 is all about. He hasn't abandoned that. I wanted people to really understand, that was my point, to understand replacement theology and see how you get there. And that was probably confusing to people. Why would I spend some time talking about the other side from a sympathetic perspective? But I think that's important in God's family to understand why people hold the positions they hold.
Well, it's also interesting. You noted that, you know, since 1948 and then again 1968, things have changed to where the dispensational view, you know, it might not be so crazy to jump on that bandwagon now. But someone, I think, had an interesting question after church, which was, okay, well, there's still not a temple, though. Why is that? If Israel is controlled by the Jews and they have Jerusalem, why don't they have a temple?
Yeah, and that was a really good question because it seems so simple to us. If Israel's in control, just go up and build a temple. When they took control of the Temple Mount, they should have taken control of it. Instead, I think, and I'm not an expert on this, but it would take quite a bit of evidence to prove me wrong on this. But I think that since the Al-Aqsa Mosque was already on the temple site and the Dome of the Rock, which used to be a church, when the Crusaders took it over, it functioned as a church. Since it was on the temple site, I think the Jews thought, instead of aggravating the situation, let's allow them to control that because they're going to worship up there. I'm of the opinion that if the Jews controlled the Temple Mount, they would have allowed for the Muslims to go and worship. I firmly believe they would have done that. I've been up on the Temple Mount three times. All three times we cannot carry a Bible up there. You cannot be wearing a cross up there. You cannot pray up there. Jews cannot pray up there. You cannot hold hands with your spouse up there. And the Muslims walk around and they are kind of policing what you're saying. In fact, the second time I was up there, a Muslim got in an argument because our tour guide, an archaeologist, was calling it the Temple Mount. And he said, this is not a Temple Mount. They want to argue about it. The Temple Mount itself is controlled by an arm of Jordanian Muslims called the Wawf. And they control who goes up there, who doesn't go up there. Every time I've been there, there's been some question whether we would actually get to go up there or not. And so there's a lot of politics involved in this on the one hand. On the other hand, and some people will disagree with me, but the Dome of the Rock is sitting on top of where I believe the Holy of Holies was. That's that outbreak of bedrock right there. And no one, neither Jew nor Christian nor Muslim, wants to tear down the Dome of the Rock. It's an ancient building. It's quite frankly, it's the oldest, my understanding is it's the oldest Muslim structure in the world. And so it's a very iconic building. It is that gold dome building that we see that occupies the center platform, the center of the platform of the Temple Mount. Let me just say, some people believe that it does not have to be removed. There is a small dome to the north of that called the Dome of the Spirits. Some people believe that would suffice to build the temple there. But I think God's promises are very, very precise. The Dome of the Rock, that is on a fault line of an earthquake that runs right through the Mount of Olives. I believe at any moment God could bring that down. I will bet everything I own that if it comes down, it will not be rebuilt. There will be a temple going up. And even though we don't see it now, Scripture, I think, is very clear that there will be a temple on there at some point. But right now, you know, you basically start World War III if you did that. But that fits perfect with what's going to go on during the tribulation period.
Okay, so that makes sense as far as, you know, where we are in the current events and why there's still some things left to happen as far as that timeline goes. But real quick, I guess we should back up a little bit because we've already mentioned dispensationalism and replacement theology. And you gave a very high level overview of what these two things are. Basically, replacement theology, you see no distinction between Israel and the church, whereas dispensationalism, it means that you do see a distinction between Israel and the church. That's a very, very broad brush about the two, but that's essentially, I guess, the basics of the two camps.
Yeah, and that matters. And some people would say, well, that's too simplistic because Scofield, in his Bible, he has seven dispensations. The different dispensations that come in, you know, that can be debated. One of my professors, Elliot Johnson, I just saw him do an argument for four dispensations. So it's not like those time periods in and of themselves define dispensationalism. If you agree that Israel and the church are distinct from one another, then what comes after that is huge in ecclesiology, the study of the church and what the church should do. And like I said, we borrowed some of that talking in some denominations using the term priest, infant baptism, some of that terminology, trying to equate it with what's going on in the Old Testament. So it matters there. It also matters in your eschatology. And that's the reason at the end of my message, I went to Revelation and I talked about the 144,000. I mean, where the Jewish tribes, where are the Jewish tribes really named except in the book of Revelation, except towards the end? I think that's an argument that, you know, they're coming back in. It matters that they're Jewish. It matters. Their sexuality matters. It points out in chapter 14, I believe it's verse 4, 144,000 Jewish men who have never known a woman. So those details matter. We just can't brush them away and say, well, that's analogous to the church and there's going to be some people there. Recently, I heard someone argue that the two witnesses that are in Jerusalem that receive mortal wounds and then rise again, the person was dogmatic. These two witnesses are the church and Israel. And I said, no, because it's a time of Jacob's trouble. That's what that's called. You got to ask yourself, what's the purpose of the tribulation? What's the purpose of God's wrath? Anytime you talk about God's wrath, God unleashes his wrath for a response of repentance, a response of faith. And all through the book of Revelation, that is not the response. He's arguing for that response. He's got witnesses, Jewish witnesses during that time, but mankind they don't respond in faith. So that's the reason I say that distinction matters in ecclesiology and it matters in eschatology, the distinction between the church and Israel.
I know that you had a lot of scripture in this, but there was even more that you decided to cut out just, I guess, for the sake of time. Just there was so much to get through, so many examples of where that distinction happens. But you also brought it to today. You did the so what. You know, you mentioned last week on the podcast, what is the reason why someone should get out of bed and come to church to listen to this? What's the takeaway? And so if you just wouldn't mind reiterating that for those who might not have caught it or haven't listened to it yet.
Yeah. First of all, I would say one big scripture I left out was Ezekiel 37 verses 15 to 28. If someone wanted to go and read that, that would be helpful. I think that would shine light on this whole topic. What I wanted people to see is simply this. God's promises will come through. If you would have asked someone in the 1500s, in the 1200s, in the 1800s, especially the early 1800s, you know, God promised there's going to be an Israel. He promised there's going to be a bringing people back from all the nations, all the ethnic Jews all over the world. He's going to bring them back. Do you believe that? They'd say, look around and they'd say, no way. That's impossible. It cannot happen. But his promises triumph. His promises triumph over every circumstance. And the takeaway I really wanted people to grab hold in their personal lives with this was God can do, in fact, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 21 says, God can do immeasurably more than we can ask or imagine. There are times when you find yourself in a situation and you're tempted. You say, okay, do I go and figure this out? Do I go with what I think's best? Or do I trust that God is going to show up? And our eyes can fool us at times. If we learn anything from that sermon, it is God will triumph and stand by his promises in the particulars. You know, we tend to try to help God out. What I talked about, Eleazar of Damascus, God can do the hard. God can do the impossible. And I have found in my years on this earth that God is still at work in areas that I never dreamed he would be in people's lives. You never know what's going on the other side of the field. And God is bringing about his plans and his purposes. And there are times when we have got to make that decision. Do I stand with God? Do I stand on his promises? Or do I allow the impossibilities of the moment to not only seize my mind, but ultimately seize my heart? And that's where I really wanted to land this message.
Yeah, I mean, I always enjoy how you bring, especially in a very heady sermon like this one was, very, very much an academic sermon, more than usual, with a lot of scripture. I always appreciate how you bring it back to that so what or that application. Not that it's all about us. I mean, that's not what you're doing there. It's just, there is a way in which what we read in the Bible shows us how God is still working today. And that's an encouragement. That's something that is always good to keep in mind as we walk with him. So thanks for explaining that. And thank you all for listening to another episode of Just One More Thing from Sunrise Church.